Good morning, everybody. If you guys want to stand and praise the Lord with us, we're going to get started.
God, we are here to reach out to you, to worship you, to praise you with all of our hearts. And Lord, we pray that you would be pleased with our worship today, that you would receive what we're offering up to you. Prayers, our everything, Lord, it all belongs to you. And now, Lord, I pray that you would meet with us in a special day, a special way today, and have your will done in our lives and in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, welcome to Kingsland Baptist Church, everybody. We're glad you're here worshiping the Lord. And we're starting our service off with something that is extremely special. And we've had a bunch of babies born in this church the last few months and others that are on the way. And we also have some that are coming back to us today. And I want to introduce you to a family. In just a moment, I'm going to call them up. Price and Laura Sparkman were members of our church for several years. And they have moved to Indianapolis and are both employed there and raising their family. And God has blessed them. They're back with us this week. And in fact, they took a trip this week, and my wife and I had the incredible privilege of hanging out with their kids this week. They stayed in our house. There's a picture of them there. And that's Kylie. That's their youngest. And they asked if we would dedicate her today. So I think that's pretty special and a real honor for our church to be involved in something like that. Kingsland knows the Sparkmans. Many of you remember the Sparkmans. We've celebrated with them and we've cried with them. This family is evidence that God is real and desires to show himself strong. For over a year, their daughter, Lexi, prayed for a baby sister. And in a way that most claim impossible, God answered Lexi's prayer. 2 days before Kylie was born, God directed her birth mom to the Sparkmans. Together, we thank her birth mom for choosing life, and we thank God for blessing the Sparkmans with Kylie Shay. Her name means generous and blessed, and was chosen based on Ephesians 3:20 that says, "Now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works within us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end." And we do glorify him. We do praise him for what he has done, for all of our gifts, for all of our blessings, which is a major theme of what we talked about today, what we're going to talk about today and what we talked about last week. So I'd like to invite Price and Laura to come on up. And they're going to bring little Kylie there. And we have a beautiful little baby Bible for her. And a certificate for her. And you want to take that, Mom? There's her cute little pink Bible. And here's her cool little certificate. Let me share a scripture with you. And this is for all of us that are having little ones and having children that are having little ones, that are grandparents, and those of us that are serving the little ones, for our whole church. Ephesians 6 says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land." And I think about Price and Laura growing up and honoring their mom and dad, respectively, who were godly people, and it has gone well with them, and they were given long lives. Verse 4 says, "Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the instruction of the Lord, the training and the admonition of the Lord." That's your job, Price. And Laura, that's your job, to bring Lexi and Kylie up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. And we just pray for God's blessings on you as you endeavor to do that, and with the help of those around you that love the Lord, and realizing that we dedicate babies to Jesus because we are really dedicating parents to bringing them up in the right environment and serving the Lord and doing what they need to do, and hoping and praying like crazy that they will find Jesus, that she will find Jesus at a young age and serve him all the days of her life. So Kylie, I'm going to pray for you now. And you want to come over to me for a minute? I doubt you do. You want to come here for a minute? Let me pray for you. And isn't she cute? Monday morning at 6:30, last Monday morning at 6:30, Kylie and I watched Snow White together. I slept through most of it. I'm not going to lie to you. But she's very dependable. 6:30, boom, on the spot. And we had a lot of fun with Lexi and Kylie this week. And we love this family. And we want to pray just God's rich blessings on them as they get started out with her, this young, handsome couple, getting started out in life with a little one. And I'm sure they would appreciate your prayers too. So would you bow with me in prayer? And Lord, we love you. We worship you. We praise you. And we thank you for all of your blessings. And I'm holding just one of life's most rich blessings in my arms here, Lord. I know that Price and Laura just see her as a gift directly from you. And Lord, in your word, it says that you give and you take away. Either way, blessed be the name of the Lord. So we bless you in the good times, and they've blessed you in the very, very hard times too. And they've stayed faithful to you. And I pray, Lord, that they wouldn't grow weary in well-doing, but they will continue to faithfully serve you and to bring Lexi and now Kylie up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. Amen. Good job. There you go. Let's stand together and continue worshiping.
Let us sing our freedom.
saved by God. We're children of God. We can sing this song, Revelation song, knowing that he's worthy, he's holy. He's more than we can ever imagine that he is. And he's just so great that he saved us and we can have revelation.
Thank you.
Father God, we're thankful for today and just the opportunity to worship you through song, through hearing your word here in just a minute. We pray for Pastor Pat as he's going to proclaim your word today. But God, also, you are worthy of everything, including the things that you bless us with. And God, as we come just to give back from what you have given us, Lord, we ask that you bless it and use it in a way that's mighty and powerful, that changes both the area surrounding Kingsland, but also to the ends of the earth. And Lord, that's our prayer and that's our hope. Lord, we want you to move in a way that we can only say that you are worthy and that you are amazing. In Jesus' name.
Turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 48. We're going to be in Genesis chapter 49, but we're going to start with a verse in chapter 48. And while you're doing that and they're finishing up passing the offering plate, let's do something I don't think we've ever done before. First of all, tonight, let's talk about tonight, and we'll talk a little bit about Friday. Tonight we have our night of worship, and we want you all to come back, and we want you to bring your friends. So, I don't think I've ever told you to do this before. If you have a smartphone, why don't you pull that thing out? If you've never liked Kingsland Baptist Church on social media, if you just go to Facebook and pull up Kingsland, you can like us on Facebook right now. It's very easy. If you're not on Facebook, if you're on Instagram, do it there. If you don't do any of that stuff, pick up the phone and make a phone call. But I would encourage you, after you've liked us on Facebook, to just share the concert tonight, the worship concert tonight, with all your friends and invite them to come. Or if you text or email or whatever you do, go to your neighbor. We've done all that. And we're going to have a special night tonight. We want you to come and be a part of that. And we want for you and to invite your friends to come and be a part of that. That's tonight at 6:30 back here. On Friday, we're starting our second year of doing the Good News Club at Curtis Elementary School. And we want to stop and pray for our workers. We have ones that show up on Fridays. I'm going to be there Friday. Pastor Justin and I are going to be going almost every Friday. One of us will be at it most Fridays. We have people who are on the prayer team. We have ones who work behind the scenes. And then we have the ones that are there. And Arita Anderson has started this last year. And I'm sure she could use more help on Fridays. If you're looking to be part of it, you have to register and do a background check and all that stuff. I just did that on Thursday myself. But it's a worthy ministry. It's a great ministry for our Good News Club at Curtis Elementary School. So we want to pray for God to bless us. We want to pray for children to come to Christ. We want to pray for our leaders to maintain their sanity for 7 weeks in a row on Fridays. If you're looking to help, talk to Rita Anderson or come talk to me. I'll put you in touch with her. But I thought it was worthy of us just stopping and praying for God's blessings on these things we're doing this week. Our night of worship tonight, our programs on Wednesday night, and certainly on a Friday starting this club out again this year. So would you bow with me in prayer? And Lord, we specifically want to ask for your strength, for your enabling, for your presence, for your hand to be upon these endeavors. Our night of worship tonight, may it just be something sweet. May it be something that all of us will truly enjoy being a part of. Lord, we pray for our every Wednesday night bus ministry, Awana ministry, all the ministry of the kids and the adults. It's a fantastic undertaking. It takes a lot of work and a lot of time and a lot of effort from so many people, but without your enabling it and making it great, it's just another thing. It's just another program. So Lord, we pray that you'd be with us this week in what we're doing. And specifically, right now, we're lifting up our Good News Club to you, asking, Lord, that you would bless Rita Anderson and bless her leaders and the kids that will come. And Lord, we pray for children to get saved, for children to have a lot of fun, for children to see that worshiping Jesus is great and exciting. And Lord, we just pray that you would bless it, put your hand upon it. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray these things. Amen. Okay, so last week we talked about God's blessings, how he just delights in blessing us from Genesis 48. And if you go back to Genesis 48, verse 21, I want to remind you of the verse we closed on. And we talked about living the blessed life. When God is present, he protects. Wherever God guides, he provides. This is the best life. This is the blessed life. God delights in blessing his people. Look at Genesis 48, verse 21. This is Jacob blessing Joseph specifically. Today we're going to look at Jacob blessing all of his sons. But in verse 21 of Genesis 48, then Israel said to Joseph, Israel is Jacob. And he says, behold, I'm about to die, but God will be with you and will bring you again to the land of your fathers. This is a powerful blessing. Everything last week rotated around this verse. Everything this week kind of jumps off or springs off of this verse. God will be with you. That's God's presence. And God will bring you again to the land of your fathers. That's God's providing and his protection in your life. And by the way, that verse was fulfilled just about 400 years later when Israel would come back to the land of Canaan. And in another way, that verse, that prophecy, I will bring you again to the land of your fathers, that verse was fulfilled prophetically in 1948 when Israel moved, when the Jews moved back into the land of Israel, taking back their homeland. This has prophetic importance. This is very real, even in our lives today. When Jacob says, hey, you're here in Egypt now, you're away now, you're spread out now, but you're going to come back to your homeland someday. It's never happened before in the history of the world. And Israel is now in their homeland, which is a reminder that Jesus is coming back. Because in the end times prophecies in Revelation, it talks about a temple, talks about Israel. All of that had to literally take place for Jesus to literally come back. He could come back right now. So we are blessed. We are so blessed. God supremely blesses our lives with his presence, with his power. He is with us in good times and in bad. He's guiding us each step of the way to ultimate victory. Now, he's blessed us for a reason. That's what we're going to talk about today. He's blessed us for a reason. He didn't just accidentally do that or haphazardly do that. He blesses us for a very specific reason. I'm going to share three of them in just a minute. But last week, I wanted to do something that I didn't get around to doing, so I'm going to do it today. And that is, I wanted to just share with you how God has blessed my life. But when you do that, when you give a testimony, sometimes it's like, well, you know, is he bragging about all? No, certainly not that. I've had a lot of good times, a lot of hard times. But God's blessed my life. And I didn't do it last week, but I felt compelled strongly to start today by just saying, God has been so good to me. We ask folks to come up and give testimonies once in a while. Wanted to do that tonight at the concert and in service. Just say, here's how God blessed my life. Here's how I came to Christ. Or here's how God healed me or whatever it may be. Here's my testimony. Here's how God has blessed my life. First of all, he gave me life in 1973 on October 18th, 1973. He gave me life. That's a big deal in 1973 because that's the year Roe versus Wade was ruled on and abortion was legalized in America, the year I was born. I thank God that my mother gave me a chance at life, and God gave me life. Around 1980, 1979, God gave me eternal life. I came to Christ early. I realized I was a sinner. I was a little boy. I went to church and all that kind of stuff, but I was a sinful little boy, and I knew that. And boy, when that revival preacher banged on the pulpit and yelled, I mean, the fear of God just went right down my backbone as a little kid. I can remember that very clearly, having a healthy fear of God from birth. I think my parents helped me with that too. But I came to Christ. I got saved. I was born again. Even as a little kid, you can be born again. That's what happened to me. I grew up in the 1980s in school, in high school. Great teachers, great coaches, great pastors. My childhood pastor sent me a letter this week. I'd written him a month before. He sent me back a letter. It was so encouraging. It was so good to hear from him. He's still faithfully serving Jesus at 70 years old. And I just thank God that that's the case. He's also my brother's father-in-law. So I had some really good things. I will admit we grew up socially, economically challenged, you might say, poor. I wore all my brother's clothes. This is after he had, like, disgusting armpit stains in it. But his shoes, his clothes. I remember I had a friend up the street, Chris, good friend. He's still a friend. He used to give me his shoes when he was done with them. Now, as a kid, I didn't know that was pathetic. I didn't know that was pitiful. I just knew the shoes looked good to me. They were cool because Chris had them. And until I outgrew them, my foot got bigger than his. And then I couldn't do that anymore. But I remember being given shoes from a buddy, the cleats to play football or baseball. And he knew we were in bad shape. His family knew that, and they blessed us. In fact, a few years ago, he gave us football tickets, my wife and I. He still gives me stuff all these years later. And but God blessed. God provided. God in 1994, God gave me something. I would say he blessed me with something very precious. He called me to preach. He did that on a morning after class. It was a homiletics class where you learn to preach. I was in that class. I didn't know if the Lord wanted me to be a missionary or a preacher or a youth pastor or whatever, a coach, teacher. And but that day, the Lord very specifically spoke to me, very clearly put that on my heart, walking out of that class and walking back to my dorm room in 1994. I want you to preach in English. I'd just gone on a mission trip to Russia. And let me tell you, I couldn't even memorize the alphabet over there. I was there for a month and never even memorized the alphabet, much less the language. I felt like the Lord was saying, no, you're going to stay here and preach in English for the most part in America. In 1998, God gave me the best blessing of them all. He gave me my wife, Elizabeth. We were married. That was a big-time answer to prayer for a young man, especially wanting to go into ministry, and I needed a godly wife. He gave me one. In fact, that year, God really transformed our lives not long after we were married. We were part of a revival service, a revival services in Chattanooga, where God just stepped down and did amazing things. He worked in Elizabeth's life in a life-changing way, and in my life, too. We've never been the same. That was 20 years ago. A couple years later, God blessed me with a church to serve at, which was a big deal. Coming out of Christian college, looking for a place to go, it was Kingsland Baptist Church. Here we are. We've been here for 17 years. Came up here to work with as the minister of youth and worship. So I used to lead the singing. And some of you were here for that. It's a long time ago. But God just blessed us. We saw a lot of kids come to Christ. And God just worked in our lives. In 2001, 2003, and 2006, God brought in the most beautiful little blessings into our lives ever, our children. And then in 2007, God blessed me with a church to pastor. Same one, still here. Same church I was already at. And that was 10 years ago. And here we are. And God's still blessing. And it's just crazy how God, he provides you what you need. He gives you the food you need. He gives you the clothes you need. He gives you the cars you need. He gives you the people you need, the education, the books, the tools, everything needed, even the team. I thank God for our deacons and our staff and the teachers in our church, our band, our leaders, everybody. More happy with them than ever. He has blessed me greatly, and I could go on and on and on and on. But here's the way I look at it. The car he gave me, the house, the clothes, the food, the tools, the position, the talents, they're all tools to be used for his purposes. God blessed me for a reason. Now, I've talked about me to start off the service. I'm going to try not to do much more of that today. Let's talk about Kingsland. And we're not even going to really talk about Kingsland that much today, but let me just say something about Kingsland, and then we're going to talk about you. The rest of the day, it's going to be all about you, okay? You and Jesus. You were blessed to be a blessing. There are opportunities in this church. This night of worship, get on your phone or get on your whatever you do and bless somebody. The people that I've invited to this thing, I invite people to church all the time. And it's usually like, okay, whatever, get away from me, weirdo. I've invited the people I invited this night of worship, the concert, free concert, that's all you got to say. It's a different response. It's been a curiosity. It's a good chance to get some of your friends and neighbors into church. You're blessed to be a blessing. How about this Good News Club? Kids Zone. Happening right now. We still need help. Our work day coming up in a few weeks. Now, that's where you can literally take your tools, if you have a weed eater, you could really use that, bring it with you, and help. Last time we did it, it was just a great time of fellowship, hanging out, cleaning stuff, painting stuff, doing stuff here at the church. We're going to do Bless Petersburg, which I know some of you don't want to go to Petersburg. I understand that. But we're going to go and bless Petersburg with the SBCV in November. And Tom Melvin, do you remember Tom Melvin, our missionary that lived with us? He's going to come in a few weeks, and he's going to share some specifics about Bless Petersburg. In fact, that's week after next when we have our combined service with the Nueva Esperanza. He's going to come and encourage both churches to get involved in Bless Petersburg one Saturday in November. How about Operation Christmas Child, the shoeboxes? How about Lottie Moon? That's just literally money that you're giving to support our nearly 5,000 missionaries. I found out this week at the SBCV board meeting that in September, a lot of churches collect money for Vision Virginia, had a big goal, and we're going to reach our goal, and that's an encouraging thing. That happens every year. But just the week before that, many churches, including ours, but many churches like ours, collected money to support these people that have been victimized in the hurricanes. I found out this week that the SBCV churches have collected $260,000 above and beyond the Vision Virginia, which is almost that amount, to help people. In other words, we have a lot of generous, kind-hearted people that go to these churches that realize, hey, I was blessed to be a blessing. So now let's talk about what on earth we're supposed to do with our blessings. And let me start by sharing a couple stories with you, sad stories from Las Vegas, where at least 59 people died, 500 people were injured in Las Vegas on October 1st, last Sunday. Jonathan Smith is likely to spend the rest of his life with a bullet lodged in his left side, the left side of his neck, a never-ending reminder of trying to help save people after a gunman opened fire on the crowd at the Route 91 Harvest Country Music Festival. Smith said, listen, I decided I'm not going to leave anybody behind. Now let that absorb into your heart for a minute. You need to make that your motto. That we need to make that our motto in this church. I'm not going to leave anybody behind. He rescued several family members and also several strangers before being shot. Then an off-duty San Diego police officer saved his life. The officer came out, came over and tried to stop his bleeding and flagged down a passing truck to get Smith a ride. See, in Las Vegas, you saw the worst of one demented, demonic, evil human being, but you saw the best of hundreds of citizens. Taylor Winston, a United States Marine veteran, helped rescue victims during the Las Vegas shooting attack Sunday with quick thinking that he credited to his military training. Winston used a utility pickup truck he found on the concert grounds and transported more than 30 people to the hospital before the ambulances could arrive on the scene. He made three separate trips back and forth. He went to the hospital, then he went back to what was a war zone to rescue people's lives. He did that three times to save people. These two men blessed others at great risk to their own lives. So the question is, who are you blessing? Are you willing to take a risk to bless somebody? Are we willing to get out of our comfort zone and be a blessing? God has blessed your life for a reason. Now go over to Genesis 49 and let's look at this chapter. We're not going to study it in depth. We're going to kind of peruse through it because this is an interesting chapter. Jacob is blessing his sons. That means he's blessing them, he's encouraging them, he's praying for them, he's giving them things. This is an old, very old, archaic story about an old man who's going to die and leave an inheritance to these sons. He's not going to leave, it was the normal practice to leave more to the older and less and less and less. He's not going to do it that way. In fact, when you read what he says to his older sons, it's going to sound less like a blessing and more like a slap in the face. But that's how Jacob operated in Genesis 49. Are you there? Then Jacob called his sons and said, gather yourselves together that I may tell you what shall happen to you in the days to come. And we're going to see the 12 tribes of Israel in this. Assemble and listen, O sons of Jacob. Listen to Israel, your father. So he's prophesying over them. He's saying what's going to come. And this is being recorded in Scripture because some of this stuff, it took thousands of years to come to fruition. Some of it is really yet to come to fruition. Verse 3, Reuben, you're my firstborn, my might, and the first fruits of my strength, preeminent in dignity and preeminent in power. That sounds pretty good. It's about to go downhill quick for Reuben. Unstable as water, you shall not have preeminence because you went up to your father's bed. Then you defiled it. He went up to my couch! Exclamation mark. What does that mean? Well, that means that he slept with Bilhah, Jacob's concubine. Bilhah was the mother of Dan and Naphtali. This is sick, okay? Two of the tribes of Israel, Bilhah was their mother. Reuben went up into the bed and had relationships with Bilhah, Jacob's son. So Jacob points that out. The Bible's kind of ugly sometimes, really. I mean, it's just, right there. Verse 5, Simeon and Levi are brothers. Weapons of violence are their swords. Let my soul come not into their counsel. Oh, my glory, be not joined to their company. For in their anger they killed men. In their willfulness they hamstrung oxen. Cursed be their anger, for it is fierce in their wrath, for it's cruel. Do you remember when Dinah was raped, their sister was raped, and they went, and instead of just taking vengeance out on the guy who did it, they killed all the men of Shechem. We studied that story a few weeks ago. They really went off disproportionately to what had happened. Okay, Judah, let's get positive. Your brothers shall praise you. It's interesting language there. Your hand shall be on the neck of your enemies. Your father's son shall bow down before you. He's talking to me, that sounds a lot like Joseph. Remember, Joseph said that the brothers would bow down to them, and they had. But Jacob is saying something special about Judah. Judah is a lion's cub. From the prey, my son, you have gone up. He stooped down. He crouched as a lion and a lioness. Who dares arouse him? Three times talks about lion. What was Jesus? Jesus was the lion of the tribe of Judah. So he, in fact, it gets more specific in verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him. And to him shall be the obedience of the peoples, plural, peoples, or your translation might say nations. So Judah is going to have a leader that is the leader of the nations. We'll come back to that later. In verse 13, Zebulun shall dwell in the shore of the sea. In verse 14, Issachar is a strong donkey crouching between the sheepfolds. In verse 16, Dan shall judge his people as one of the tribes of Israel. In verse 19, raiders shall raid Gad. That's interesting. Raiders shall raid Gad, but he shall raid at their heels. Raiders shall raid Gad. In Hebrew, Gad is synonymous with raiders. It sounds like raiders or raid. So he's doing a play on words, which Jacob does in this a lot. Raiders shall raid Gad, but he shall raid at their heels. Asher's food shall be rich, and he shall yield royal delicacies. Naphtali is a doe let loose that bears beautiful fawns. And then Joseph in verse 22. Now we know Joseph's blessings went to Ephraim and Manasseh, both of which became tribes of Israel. Levi didn't get any land. Levi was the priestly tribe, so that's how you have the 12 tribes, if you're keeping count. Joseph is a fruitful bow by a spring. His branches run over the wall. The archers bitterly attacked him. They shot at him and harassed him severely. I mean, this is just the truth. Joseph had a troubled life, and his brothers turned against him. It's like he was under fire. If you ever felt that way, well, keep reading. Yet his bow remained unmoved. His arms were made agile by the hands of the mighty one of Jacob. From there is the shepherd, the stone of Israel. By the God of your father who will help you, by the Almighty who will bless you. So Joseph was blessed. Ephraim and Manasseh were blessed. In verse 27, you have the youngest. Benjamin is a ravenous wolf in the morning, devouring the prey, and at the evening, dividing the spoil. And I know that language is kind of cryptic and it's a little bit hard for us to understand, but Jacob is giving his blessings to his sons who will all return to Canaan in the time of Moses transferring to Joseph going over the Jordan, to Joshua going across the Jordan and then occupying those lands. Each one of these sons will become big tribes. We're talking millions of people. Right now there's only 70 when Jacob is speaking. But history records they became a multitude. Okay, so God has blessed your life, and Jacob was giving his blessings onto his son. He wanted them to be blessed. He's blessed your life for a reason. Let's start. Number one, why? Why has God blessed your life? Number one, he blessed your life for his own glory and for his sovereign purposes. Go back to Jacob. Why did God pick Jacob over Esau? Because he felt like it. You ever tell your kids that? Because I said so. Just deal with it. I don't know why. God had a plan. And he favored Jacob. You see, he blessed you for his own glory and you for his own sovereign purposes. He chose to bless you for his own reasons. And each one of us, I gave my little testimony today, each one of us could share your testimony. Some of you have come to Christ later in life. He saved you before you died. You missed hell because God saved you at relatively later in life. Others of us grew up in church, and you came to Christ early, and you're blessed that way. God does what he's going to do for his own reasons. He blessed Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, the 12 sons, for a reason. He blessed them in an extraordinary way because he was using them for his purposes. He was establishing his very own nation through this family. He was going to use this family to provide redemption. That's a big word, folks, redemption. He was going to redeem humanity in order to bring glory to himself. He had a master plan, and they were just a small part of that plan, just like you and me. We're just a small part in his plan. So stay faithful in good times and bad. Trust him. Just remember Joseph in that prison or being enslaved? God had a plan for him. It's a good thing he didn't give up. Fast forward up to the 1950s to Elizabeth Elliot. Do you remember Elizabeth Elliot in 1956? She and her husband and others went to reach the Alka Indians. And her husband, Jim Elliot, Nate Saint, the other men, five of them, were speared to death by the very people they were trying to reach. Now, if you're afraid to go to Petersburg, that's probably not going to happen to you down there. These men left everything. And Jim Elliott's the one who said, he is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he can never lose. And he died. He spilled his blood out there on that beach that day. But his wife, this woman, stayed. So did her friend Rachel Saint. They stayed. And they went back to those same savage people. And they taught them to read. And they taught them the Bible. And they got saved. And they started churches. It's just an amazing thing that happened. It didn't start that way, though. It started with her husband being killed. See, God has blessed you in order to bring himself glory. And he does this for his own reasons. And at the same time, we have hard times. We struggle. You may be struggling right now. Don't give up. Surrender to God's plan for your life. It's about his plan, not your agenda. Accept that his will is supreme. It's far more important than yours. His agenda trumps yours. Ask him to show you what he wants from you. Last week was what he does for you. Today, I'm suggesting that we stop and consider what he wants from us. Stay faithful in the good times and the bad. A couple weeks ago, Natalie Grant, the great Christian musician, was diagnosed with thyroid cancer. I just feel so bad for her. She has this amazing instrument. Her voice is just powerful and has been used by God, and she's so humble, and she's done so much. And you just scratch your head and go, how can she get cancer? How does that happen? Why does that happen? I don't have any answers for that other than to say it has happened. And this woman's staying faithful to Christ. She's going to have the surgery. She's going to go through the treatments, and she's staying faithful to the Lord. She knows that he blessed her life for his own glory, and he's allowing difficulty to come into her life for his own sovereign purposes. We're blessed by God, for God, not ourselves. So why has God blessed you? Because he chose to. And why didn't he give the guy down the street what he's given you? Because he chose not to. It's just that simple. He's sovereign. Secondly, he blessed you anticipating that you would worship him. Now, this is where it gets, we're going to talk about God, then we're going to talk about others, but let's talk about God. He blessed you anticipating that you would praise him and glorify him. Turn over to Psalm 100. It was David who said, I will bless the Lord at all times, at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. Are you in Psalm 100? Keep your finger over there in Genesis, but let's read Psalm 100 together. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with thanksgiving. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us. And we are his. We are his people in the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. Why? Why is all this? Because the Lord's good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. In other words, regardless of what your friend does, regardless of what your closest friend does, regardless of what anybody does, you just need to praise the Lord. He saved you anticipating that you would worship him, that you would inconvenience yourself when you don't feel like singing to go ahead and sing, when you don't feel like giving to go ahead and give, when you don't feel like getting out of bed to get on out of bed, when you don't feel like sharing the gospel, when you don't feel like reaching out to somebody to just go ahead and do it anyway. Most of us don't feel like getting up and exercising. Some of us do it anyway. Most of us don't want to eat right. Some of us do anyway. And it makes a huge difference on your life, doesn't it? He blessed you anticipating that you would praise him and glorify him. In Psalm 100, in verse 1, sing. If you want to worship him and bless him, sing. In verse 2, serve. Serve the Lord. In verse 3, look down on it, to know him. He wants you to know him intimately and then to follow him. He's the shepherd, we're the sheep. Sheep aren't super bright. Sheep aren't super athletic. There's not anything that special about them. They're just sheep, and they follow the shepherd, and that's what we were called to do, to follow him as our good shepherd. And then verse 4, to give. Give. In this context, it's talking about giving thanks, but give, just in general. Just give. In other words, we are tempted to take, take, take. Have you ever noticed? I've noticed that people that give always have more to give. People that take never seem to have enough. Some of them are very faithful at it. I'm amazed at how consistent some of the people I pass by on Willis Road are out there taking. Had my bottled water ready today to give it to one of them. She wasn't there. I couldn't believe it. I was shocked that she wasn't there. We fed her on Monday nights. We've shared the gospel with them. We helped them. But they're more faithful to that sometimes than some Christians are to serving the Lord. It's a lot of hard work being out there in the hot sun. But I've noticed that people that are takers, they just keep taking. They just have to keep taking. And that givers, God just gives them more and more and more to give. According to Barna Research, the Barna Group in 2011, a 2011 poll by Barna Group, among the most generous in the United States population segments were, guess who they were? Because we bust on church people a lot, and for good reason. Sometimes church people are horrible, and they whine, and they, you know, whatever. According to the Barna poll in 2011, the most generous U.S. population segments were evangelicals, conservatives, people who pray, who read the Bible, and attend church service during the past week, Christians. Among the least generous are people under the age of 25. Hey, that's just the research. I'm just sharing what happened. Atheists and agnostics, single adults who have never been married, liberals, and downscale adults. I'm not even sure what that means, downscale adults. I'm pretty sure I am a downscale adult. 1% or less of those people in each of those segments tithe. Now check this out. Among all born-again adults, 9% of born-again Christians contribute 1/10 or more of their income. Now I just told you that these evangelical Christians are the most generous people in the poll. And only 1/10 of them give a tenth, which is kind of pitiful anyway. We should be way better off than that. We should be doing way more than that. It should be a much higher percentage. But in having 1/10 of our people give 1/10, we are the most generous people in the poll. So God's people should understand that he has blessed them lavishly, and he therefore deserves our praise and our worship, our money, our time, our lives. Never forget that God gave you everything you have, and he expects you to manage what he has temporarily placed in your hands in a faithful and in a generous manner. He deserves to be praised. He desires to be worshiped. He's so good. He's awesome. He's worthy of our praise and our sacrifices. So the application is, just say thank you, Jesus. Can we do that together? Just together, like 1, 2, 3. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. One more time. Thank you, Jesus. Man, he's so good to us. Praise him, worship him, glorify him, honor him, adore him, give to him. He blessed you anticipating that you would praise him. Number 3, let's close. He blessed you expecting that you would be a blessing to others. In the name of Jesus, he blessed you so that you would be a blessing to others. You know, he typically uses people to bless people. In the Bible, he poured down manna and quail. That was pretty cool. But for the most part, he uses people to bless people. I mean, that's what Jacob was a person who blessed his sons, who were 12 persons, in amazing ways. He uses people to bless people. So, I mean, hasn't that been your experience, that people bless you and you're like, man, thank you, Jesus, out of nowhere, something happens? Or maybe you've been a blessing to somebody. So that's really the question today. Who are you blessing? How are you blessing anybody? When was the last time you did something for someone expecting nothing in return? Someone that could never pay you back? That's convicting for me. I mean, we're human beings. We have to eat. We have to, like, I don't know, make money and pay our bills. I'm not discouraging that. I'm just saying, are you willing to help somebody who could never, ever possibly pay you back? That's what Christianity is all about. More important than rules, more important than religion or rituals or liturgy or whatever. What is Christianity? God in Christ gave us the free gift of salvation that we could never pay him back. And he doesn't want us to pay him back. He just wants us to receive it and to love him and to praise him and to share the good news with others. See, we're tempted to get caught up in our own problems. I am. Aren't you? I mean, aren't we tempted to just kind of get overwhelmed with our own hurts and heartaches and problems and debt and family issues and whatever? Don't you realize anybody that ever helped you, they had problems too? Everybody you've ever helped, you didn't do that in the absence of not having any problems. You did it anyway. Look back at verse 10. I want you to see this. I'm going to read this in the New King James in our text. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver, a ruler's staff, from between his feet, until Shiloh comes. Shiloh is a very important word. That's the Messiah. And to him shall be the obedience of the peoples, nations, that's plural. Jacob indicated that his offspring would rule beyond Israel. This is referring to Jesus ruling the nations. He is our example. So what did Jesus do? Go back to the bracelets, WWJD. What did Jesus do? Or what would Jesus do? He sacrificed. He served. He gave. He gave everything. He's our example. Let's think about this historically. Back to this Jacob and what happened. God had already determined that Judah would be the royal tribe. And that his line would include the king of Israel, that's David. 640 years later, that's exactly what happened. And later on, far later on, Jesus, 1,700 years later. The predictions he makes in these verses have yet to be completely fulfilled, but will come to pass during Christ's millennial kingdom reign in the future. God blessed Jacob by making his descendants kings. Isn't that awesome? He was blessed in order to be a blessing to others. His great-grandson David brought freedom and unprecedented wealth and prosperity to the nation of Israel. He led Israel to sing praises to the Lord. Ultimately, Jacob's supreme descendant, Jesus, blessed the world by shedding his blood and making redemption available. He is the supreme example of blessing others. He's the one who told each and every one of us, just three words, four words, so send I you. Remember when Jesus said that? So send I you. That's what he's commissioned us to do. It's inconvenient. It's costly, it's tiresome, it's scary, it's intimidating, it's hard, but it's worth it. He blesses us so we can bless others and then be blessed more so we can turn around and bless others. It's kind of circular. He blesses us so that we can bless others, and when we bless others, he's just going to bless you more. For what? So you can bless others. It's awesome. So that's the application today. That's the whole sermon. Bless others. You can do it. How? Well, we're out of time. Let me just give you a couple examples. Now, really, you just need to brainstorm and think about how you can bless others. Write something down. Take some initiative. But just in case, let me throw out a few suggestions. Say a kind word. Has anybody ever given you a kind word just when you needed it and you just know how precious that is? Offer a helping hand. Give a hug. To people who want a hug. I mean, if someone's not a hugger, leave them alone. I mean, it's not like, don't assault them with hugs. But some people are into hugs. Maybe a little sideways hug, whatever. Give a hug. Share your resources. Reach out. Volunteer. Write a check. Donate blood. Offer assistance. Sign up for that next mission trip. Explain the gospel. Is there any better way to bless somebody than to share the gospel with them? I can't think of any. Confront a brother or a sister graciously. Confront when necessary. Send a note. Make a post. Send a text. Be a blessing to someone who has done nothing for you, and pour out encouragement and sympathy and compassion for someone who can maybe not, expecting nothing whatsoever in return. And I'll just give you the words of Jesus. So send I you. He did it perfectly. I don't. But he's our example. And he said, so send I you to do these things. Would you stand with me now? And I want to pray for you. I'm going to assume that every single one of us want to do this. So if you would stand with me, we're going to have our invitation song. It's an awesome song. I want you to sing it. If you want to come and pray at the altar, come and pray. Listen, if you have a burden in your life that I can pray for you about, come up and do that. Let me pray for you. If you need to get saved, you need to receive the blessing of salvation, come and receive Christ as your Savior. Would you pray with me as you stand and prepare to sing? And the message kind of divides up this way. Submit to God's sovereign plan, especially when you don't understand what he's doing. Bless his holy name regardless of your circumstances. And find someone else to bless, especially those who can't do anything for you. That's what you've been commissioned. So send I you. And some of you need to repent. Listen, you've not surrendered yourself to God's plan. You're doing your own thing. Just repent. Ask him to forgive you. If you want to come and pray at the altar, do that. If you want to come and join our church, this is our invitation. You're invited to come do that. But this is a time of decision. Maybe you've not really been blessing his name. Some people help other people. Listen, you can be lost as a doorknob and help other people and give people stuff and die and go to hell because you're lost. You need to receive Christ. You need to surrender to Jesus. And you need to start blessing him first. If you've not been praising and worshiping and thanking Jesus, repent of that sin and ask him to forgive you and offer praise to him even now. Find someone to bless. If you've been selfish and self-centered and overwhelmed with your own problems, which, you know what? I'm that way sometimes. I'm guilty. I bet some of you are too. Ask the Lord to forgive you. But true repentance means you just need to go find someone to bless, particularly someone who can't bless you back. Make this your prayer, folks. Oh, God, make me a blessing to somebody today. Every day, this week, today, would you make that your prayer? Oh, God, make me a blessing to somebody today. And Lord, I pray that you would help me to bless somebody today and tomorrow. You've given us everything we have. It belongs to you. They're tools, our cars, our homes, our clothes, our food, our money. They're just tools to acknowledge they came from you and that you're in control. To give to you and your causes and your purposes and your kingdom, and then to use to serve others. Help us to be a blessing to others in Jesus' name.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease, my comforter. My all in all, here in the love of Christ, I stand. Oh, 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 oh. Oh, 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 oh the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power in hell, no seam of
Hi, my name is Pat Fiordelise. I'm the pastor here at Kingsland Baptist Church. I want to thank you for choosing to watch our service tonight here on Comcast Cable. We're here every Friday night at 6 o'clock, and we truly appreciate that you watch it. And I do want to extend an invitation to you to come join us right here on a Sunday morning at 11 o'clock at Kingsland. We're located at 8801 Perrymont Road here in Richmond, Virginia. And if you want to find out more information about our church, it's available at kingslandbaptist.com. You know, tonight you may have made a decision to give your heart to the Lord. And if you did, we're so happy for you. We'd love to hear from you. If you haven't yet, we want to encourage you to receive Christ as your personal Savior. Ask Him to forgive you of your sins. Make Him the Lord of your life. And He died for you. He rose from the grave on the third day. And He said, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved if you'll confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. So if you want someone to talk to about that, call me here at the church. That's 275-1285. Or you can email me at pastor@kingslandbaptist.com. I'd be glad to talk with you about that. Our mission is to connect people with Christ. That's what we do. And you can watch all of our services at our website. Keep watching us on Comcast, or come see us personally. We would love to meet you. God bless you. Good night.
and it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. A Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it?
Steal my joy.